Blog Talk Radio.
This land is mine. God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand and walk this land with me, and walk this lovely land with me. Though I am just a man, when you are by my side, with the help of God, I know I can be.
Well, good evening. Welcome to Yada Yah Radio. I'm pleasure to be here with you this evening. We have Dee and Kirk. Happy Shabbat to one and all. I know there are those in Israel that have a conniption fit over actually speaking to people about Yahowah during the Shabbat because, well, they don't want to speak to anybody about Yahowah. And they think that the Shabbat should be the most rigorous day of the work where there's 1,000 rules on how to accomplish nothing. That certainly wasn't Yahweh's intent. He was not looking for brain-dead zombies. He was actually looking for us to celebrate our relationship with him and to spend a day each week enjoying his company. There's no better way to do that than to share the inspired testimony of his prophets, which is what we're going to do this evening. Before we go, though, there was a, shouldn't use the past tense. There is another horrible blood libel against Israel. This one is very much like the claim that Hamas made that Israel bombed the hospital that Hamas was actually using as a terrorist headquarters, and that Hamas actually shot the rocket that landed in the parking lot and may have killed a couple of terrorists, but certainly didn't kill anywhere near the number of people, not even 10% of the number of people that Hamas claimed, and 100% of them were killed by Hamas's rocket that misfired, and yet the world's media all picked up on the story and condemned Israel. There were riots around the world. This time it is it's a whole different type of an affair. Muslims are just not well behaved. I'm just sorry, but that's the truth. In fact, there's even in Great Britain this week, a very liberal prime minister in a country that is exceedingly anti-Semitic. In fact, just elected a outspoken anti-Semite to the parliament. Came and said, you know, there's a special problem with the pro-Palestinian, pro-Muslim riots and protestations in this country, because they threaten violence, they threaten to kill and annihilate a group of people, they're exceedingly disruptive and cannot be tolerated. Well, what has happened is that Muslims don't like to work. They haven't worked in a very long time. So they have lived on either stealing or handouts. And in Gaza, they are particularly good at it. Now, I don't say that to be pejorative. I mean, the fact of the matter is, read the Quran. If you think I'm speaking out of school, read the 8th surah of the Quran. It's the most important surah in the Quran. It's the surah that where Islam became Islam 2.0 after failing miserably in Petra, which is where the Kaaba was originally located, and relocating to a Jewish settlement. Some 30,000 Jews lived in Yathrib. Muhammad became a sand pirate and terrorist, and stealing is lawful and good. That's the name of the surah.
Yes.
So they didn't want to work. They didn't want to pay their loans. And so they became raiders. They really had very little difference other than they were very unsophisticated at it between them and Genghis Khan, Kublai Khan, or Tamerlane. Matter of fact, Tamerlane used Islam to be successful, which is how he created not only the – well, actually created the Ottoman Empire as a direct result of what he did. So the world is crying for the perpetrators of October 7th, a massacre where they raped and mutilated and burned alive men, women, and children and abducted them, and they're still holding them as hostage. And they're blaming Israel for all manner of things, including impeding aid relief in the poor. Little Gazians, they're dying and they're starving. Even Austin, the Secretary of Defense, who should probably go back in the hospital and have his brain checked, claimed this week that 25,000 of them have died. Oh, bull crap. It's, the Israelis have probably killed 15,000 Hamas operatives, terrorists. And there are probably 3,000 or 4,000 women and children who have been killed, none of them deliberately, all because Hamas chooses to hide under their skirts. So that, I mean, there are pictures of Hamas operatives holding a baby in one arm and an AK-47 in the other hand. You know, they place their munitions under their children's beds. The biggest stashes were under hospitals and schools. So and while the world's crying about the perpetrators of October 7th, nobody wants to rally behind those who are defending themselves. So the cry is for more humanitarian aid and a truce that enables them to be the trucks to come in. So Israel has learned that when the trucks come in, all that happens is Hamas steals the food. That's the reason why there could be tens of thousands of truckloads of deliveries, and people are pretending that they're starving to death because Hamas uses food as a weapon, and they steal it. And so the Israelis actually back in the range of a quarter mile to half a mile from the most recent caravan, they created a protective corridor for these trucks to go north and deliver food to the people. However, before they could get there, these trucks were intercepted by mobs of Muslims. I mean, mobs. It looked like ants on a sugar cane. I mean, it was just reprehensible. And they were climbing on these trucks. They were standing before the trucks. They were climbing on the hoods of the trucks. They were trying to open the doors of the truck. It was a mob scene. There was, you know, it's presented. They were standing in line and waiting for the precious food that the world was giving them because the Jews are trying to perpetrate genocide. Bull crap. They were mobbing these trucks, and the trucks couldn't make their way north to deliver the food, which is where they were intended to go, because they were besieged. And these truck drivers had to be absolutely petrified for what was happening, as they were typically swarmed by 10, 15 people deep in front, left, right, and behind each of these trucks. And when you look at the video, and there's an aerial video of the whole thing, and it plays out over a couple of minutes, there isn't a single case where somebody is running from gunfire. Not one. All they're doing is running to the trucks and then running around the trucks and then climbing on the trucks. Why? Because they want to steal what's inside of it. That's their mentality.
Right.
Allah made stealing lawful and good. So they're being run over by the trucks. They're being stampeded by other Muslims. There are no Jews that are shooting into orderly lines waiting to be fed. There's no Jews even trying to protect the IDF, trying to protect the truck drivers. You know, they're Muslims delivering food to Muslims. If the Muslims want to kill them, that's not their fault. But because there are Hamas terrorists operating within these groups of deranged Muslims, a group of them actually ran towards the IDF positions. Not there trying to get food. They're running towards the IDF positions. And the IDF knows that these men carry not only weapons, but also suicide vests. And the first thing the commander said is, shoot a warning shot in the air, and in Arabic, tell them to halt. And they did. The Muslims kept on coming. They're suicidal. Allah gave them no reason to live, only a reason to die. So they kept on coming. And the commander said, if they get within 5 meters of you, you can shoot in the leg. And so they did. And what they did is an absolute self-defense and had nothing to do with the food caravan. And yet Italy and, Germany are asking for an independent investigation. Watch the damn video, would you? Deal with the fucking people, excuse me, that are mobbing these trucks. They're disgusting. You are aiding and abetting mass murderers.
Yep.
You're disgusting. Yep. And your progressive publications, like France 24, the BBC, running with this story, claiming that the world is angry at Israel for shooting the poor little Palestinians that were standing nicely in line waiting for the international convoys of food. Are you out of your ever-loving mind?
No.
Are you just that disgusting? Are you pretending to be journalists or are you propagandists?
Absolutely.
So I just tell you, I feel sorry for Jews. You know, they're blamed for being colonizers when they've never done anything of the such. They've returned to their homeland that was colonized by the Romans. Heck, it was colonized by the Assyrians, the Babylonians, the Egyptians, the Greeks, the Romans, Ottoman Muslims, Romans out of Constantinople, the Byzantines, then Muslims again, and then the British. I mean, you want a place that's been colonized, look what happened to Israel. The only people that haven't colonized it is Israel. Then you want to call them occupiers. What are they occupying? They gave up Gaza, and look what happened.
Yeah.
The West Bank, Judea and Samaria, there's no rule that says they can't build homes there. Look at the areas they're building homes. They're wastelands. The Jews own the property, and they're building homes in the middle of deserted wastelands on hills that got nothing around them. And they turn it into farmland and grazing land.
Which is amazing.
And the world wants to condemn them, the United States in particular, for building homes. Well, those that occupy their homeland are not condemned for killing them.
Right.
It's one of the most egregious, hypocritical, absurd, irrational, ignorant claims in the history of the world. And, of course, there's no such thing as a Palestinian. And the world continues to write about these poor Palestinians when there is no such thing. There's Arab Muslims. And they already have a state. It's called Jordan. And the Sinai beckons. Israel owned it. They gave it back to Egypt. The least Egypt could do is carve out 1% of it and expand the footprint of these people. They're Muslims. Let them have them.
Egypt doesn't want much to do with the Palestinians.
No, so everything about this whole episode is revolting. And as I feel sorry for God's people, Jews, because they have no opportunity. Although I will tell you, Jews are their own worst enemy. My wife brought in a video of this 20-something tear-filled piece of crap Jewish girl who said, I saw on the train was some Orthodox Jews. She's Jewish, by the way. The Orthodox Jews. And I wondered if they were part of the colonializers. I wonder if they were occupiers.
Part
of perpetrating the genocide. And you broke out in tears. What a waste of a life. What I asked Leah to write on her Facebook page is that she should follow the example of the crackpot from the U.S. Air Force that burned himself alive while protesting genocide.
that was horrible.
Much better Stupid. Use of her life, I'll tell you that for sure. What in the world has happened to the minds of people?
Oh, nuts.
Yeah, beyond the fact that the Haredim aren't engaged in any of this. The Haredim are parasites. They don't fight. They don't do anything that's in the interest of Israel. They suck the life out of Israel. They're not serving. They don't even like Israel. They don't want to do anything until their unnamed rabbinical Messiah comes, which, of course, will never happen.
Right.
So, you just got to be a numbskull to think any of this is true. And, of course, one of the great ironies of October 7th is that apart from the IDF on duty there who were way too insufficient a force without any support from the rest of the IDF, who died in significant numbers and were kidnapped in significant numbers, which means all the IDF that are kidnapped have been tortured and are dead, which is why they're not being returned. The rest, which is 888 of the victims of that, were almost exclusively progressives. They were young men and women at a rave, a New Age rave. You're not going to a New Age rave because you're a conservative trying to support your country and its traditions. They were going to a New Age rage. Rave.
It was close to Gaza for the purpose of supporting Palestinian and Israeli relations. They went strategically
absolutely.
There.
Yeah, they chose that position because they were supportive of the cause of the Fakistinians. And the others lived on kibbutzim, which were the first communist institutions in the country. They were exceedingly liberal and reached out in every possible way to help those who were actually plotted against them and mapped where their children were going to kindergarten so they could kill them.
Yep.
And yet
make
the progressives don't learn a lesson. Just astonishing. As I say, I feel sorry for Israel. But, you know, you do have your problems, Israel, that in America and in Israel, a very significant proportion, some 20-25%, maybe even 30% of Jews are progressives. And as progressives, they're not worth the air they breathe. I'm just sorry. That is the case. It's probably the worst adaptation of religion in human history, because it not only has rendered people completely immoral, ignorant, and driven by a religious zeal, they are astonishingly anti-Semitic, and they're on the wrong side of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And they have such influence in academia and in the media, particularly in social media, that their influence is stifling, and it's exceedingly destructive. And then you have the religious wackos, the Orthodox and Haredim, which have made a god in the rabbi's image that is so far from Yahowah and the truth. And most of them, a huge percentage of them, are nothing but deadbeats and parasites. They forego an education. They forego everything. They are, by the way, hypocrites. those that would say you can't do this program on a Shabbat. They're now very active on the Shabbat because, of course, October 7th occurred on a Shabbat. So they're using their non-Shabbat cell phones to chit-chat with each other. Great violation of rabbinical Judaism. Yes, okay. I got that out of my system. Actually, not. I'll never get it out of my system. When I read these stories, when it's when they were wrong about the hospital, they've been that the numbers they're quoting of dead are coming from Hamas. They're wrong about those, and they're wrong now about this. And they show no remorse, and they continue to double down on their blood libel. I just think it's disgusting. And then I see Jews, my people, they're colonializers, they're perpetrating genocide. Listen, from the moment Islam was created, it was genocidal against Jews.
Yep.
And it has been genocidal against Jews since 1,400 years.
By his own admission.
Muhammad and Muslims wiped out Jews, took entire communities of Jews and killed them. Tortured them and killed them and raped their women, slaved their children. And it has perpetrated genocide against Jews. What do you think from the river to the sea means?
Right.
Why do you think Iran is developing a nuclear bomb? So it's just like all of the right-wing skinhead conspiratorial lies that Jews are in a secret cabal trying to eliminate the white race and rule the world, killing all Caucasians. The opposite is true, idiot. And so we as good Christians need to go kill them. Pathetic. The opposite is true. And the opposite is true on these genocide claims. No country has ever risked more to protect civilians that don't want to be protected, that are staying put just because they love Hamas. And then the President of the United States has the gall to say that the only way that Israel's going to survive is by giving these terrorists a state. He is in the lead position now for the next Neville Chamberlain. We wonder who that might be, and you know, right now my money is on Joe Biden.
Yeah.
And it's his ultimate Hail Mary. He's a good Catholic boy, so he'd appreciate that. It's the only way to salvage his reelection campaign is to get Israel to surrender its territory and form a Fakistanian state. Imagine how that's going to work. With all the weapons and terror perpetrated against Israel, now from Judea and Samaria, and from Gaza, if they had no right to go in and remove the weapons, it's Israel. It's a guarantee that Jews will die by the millions if the two-state plan is implemented to reward terrorism. We did warn Israel when Joe Biden was giving his wonderful oratory about, you know, how we're going to be in there with Israel and they have every right to defend themselves and we want to wipe out Hamas. I said he's a Trojan horse. This is going to come back to haunt you, Israel. He is a Trojan horse, and boy, is it ever. The reason, by the way, that he wants to do that is twofold. One is he's really stupid. The progressives in his party have convinced him that if he continues to even give some occasional rhetoric on behalf of Israel, that the Muslims and the young progressives, which means the thoughtless American Democrats and their youth, are going to abandon him, and he might lose the election to Trump as a result. Come on. There isn't a young progressive on this planet that's going to vote for Donald Trump.
Mm-mm.
And there isn't a Muslim of those that are protesting against Israel that are going to vote for Donald Trump. He isn't going to lose any of those votes. That's just being stupid. And then, of course, there's the Saudi Arabians, where MBS has figured out that he has America by the short hairs, and that they have to dance monkey dance, or he can pull the reserve currency status, the petrodollars, and America's economy is in shatters. And so he can use that as leverage, and nothing would make MBS a bigger hero among his people than forcing Israel to capitulate and afford a state to the Fakistanians, the very Fakistanians that he has millions upon millions of acres of deserted land with nothing on it. Like, he's building a whole city on land that they had to go release wild animals because it was uninhabited. You should see them. They bring up the cars and they release the wild animals to say, oh, well, yeah, this is a nature preserve. Open the gates of the zoos. And nothing there. And they got all this money, hundreds of billions of dollars, trillions of dollars, actually, hundreds of trillions of dollars. Nothing to them to create a Fakistanian enclave. Or Jordan to do the same thing, or put them in the Sinai. But no. Nobody wants them. They want them to die making Jews look bad because they hate Israel. And that's what you're up against,
that's
Israel.
It.
And it's only going to get worse because you are now in the time of Jacob's troubles. It's a 10-year countdown to the day of when it will all be over. I will choose to account for proclaiming in writing the decree and prescription for living of the Almighty, which Yahweh said to me, you are my son. Yahweh said to me, you are my son. This day, I bring you forth as your father. Feel free to ask questions about this, seeking to learn the answers, because literally out of me and from me, there will be an inherited share of the land of the Gentile nations that will be given to you and unto successive generations, even unto the distant reaches of the earth, perhaps even the material realm, becoming your property. Mizmowr, lyric to be sung, 2:8. You wouldn't have to read very far into Dode's Mizmowr, his Psalms, to figure out that he really is a son of God.
Mm-hmm.
Who was writing the Psalm?
Dode.
What did he say? The Almighty, which Yahweh said to me, you are my son. Why, in the so-called Abrahamic religions, which all claim that the Psalms are inspired by their God, are they ignorant of the fact that God said, I have a son, and his son's name is Dode? It means beloved. It's David. Is there any celebration of the star of the sun? Is there? Is there any study about what did God mean when he said, you are my son, I am your father?
Pretty straightforward.
Do the rabbis ever lead classes on the covenant and said, oh, maybe he's talking about the covenant? Or maybe, just maybe, he's talking about Bakowr. Oh, what's Bakowr? We don't do that anymore. Oh, that's part of matzah. Oh, what's matzah? We don't do that anymore. I guess they can't, because they don't even understand what Yahweh was talking about. And of course, then in Christianity, they created a fake Messiah and Son of God. When it says right here, Dode, you are my son.
Yep.
And I'm bringing you forth on this day. What day? Bakowr. What other day? Kippurim. One is firstborn children. Dode, of course, is called the firstborn of Yahweh.
Yeah.
And the other is the Day of Reconciliations, where Zechariah specifically says that Dode is going to be the person that's going to anoint the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant on Kippurim so that God's people could be reconciled.
Hey.
Put the pieces together. And Dode even says, feel free to ask questions about this. Seek to know. Learn the answers.
Yeah.
Inquire.
Yeah.
Why? Because from me, the inheritance comes. Well, how can Dode produce the inheritance of the covenant unless he fulfilled Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim? The only way Dode can produce it, because otherwise it's coming from God.
Yeah.
But Dode says, I'm the one that's producing it. That means that Dode fulfilled Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim. It is an inheritance. It's a nakala, the very thing that Yahweh spoke routinely and repeatedly to Abraham about. This day that Yahweh is bringing forth his son is prophetic, just like the rest of the second Mizmowr psalm of his second and third coming, of the fulfillment of Bukurim and Kippurim. It wasn't just Dode's work as a songwriter, but as a savior and future king. Now, some people have a tough time saying, well, how can Dode have come back in year 4000, and it would be 33 CE, and then, you know, he's coming back as the king. How is that possible? What do you think, that when somebody dies that's part of the covenant, that they just go poof? Do you think their soul dissipates to nothingness? Or do you think that soul is brought into Yahweh's home? And as a soul that Yahweh empowers and enables with his spirit, you think that God might just be capable of putting that soul in another body?
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think that God understands what Einstein discovered, that E equals MC squared, and that energy, which would be the equivalent of what a soul is comprised of, and spirit, and matter, which is what our bodies are comprised of, are the same thing, just different amounts of the same thing. You can go from one to the other. Einstein knew it. Don't you think maybe God knew it before Albert? So,
yeah,
it is not difficult. The thing that's difficult is what Dode volunteered to endure for his people.
Wow. Yeah, no kidding.
The pain of being the sacrificial lamb and be tortured by the Romans, the most maniacal empire on earth, maybe even the history of the earth. And then to endure matzah and take our guilt with him, with his soul into Sheol. And to think that after doing it, there wasn't a single Jew who recognized what he had done, even though he wrote all about it. He's telling you about it here. Read the 22nd Mizmor. It's Dode expressing what he would endure as the Pesach El and then on Matzah. Through crucifixion, 500 years before crucifixion was invented. 88th Mizmor, the same thing. What do you think Yeshayah is talking about in the 9th chapter? When he talks about a child is born and a son is given. And he's going to be a Gabor, which is who Dode is. The competent and courageous man of God. It even names Dode in the prophecy. And then Yeshayah 53, where it's introduced to saying, do you know who the Zoroah are? Happen to be three of them, the two of them that are really important, Moshe and Dode. And then it goes to explain that one of those Zoroah is going to serve as the Pesach Gael, take our guilt away from it and take it upon himself. That was the hard part. But there was a harder part, knowing that his own people would deny him. Not a single Jew for the next 1,970 years said a word about what he had done, even with the all the prophecies pertaining to it. And then the most popular religion in the world would specifically give all of what he had done and corrupt it and make up a myth of some mythical Iesu Christu that allegedly did and deserves the credit becoming junior God.
Mm-hmm.
We know it actually did. And of course then in Islam, Daud is a Muslim who has less merit than about 500 other people. That's what God is talking to us about. You want to see Daud and all of his glory? Wait, it's only 9 years from now when he comes back as our king, as our shepherd, as our savior. We're going to read about that here just in a moment. So Yahweh is affirming that he is bringing his Ben, son, and our Masiach, Messiah, forth to fulfill Chag Matzah, and his Melech king to reign over and defend Yisrael at the end of days. Therefore, the realization of a second coming and a third coming are true when applied to the right Masiach. The Masiach and Ben's son, Daud. Fundamentally, Sha'al, which was the word translated to question, to inquire about, to ask about, to look and search for answers, isn't Yahweh telling Daud to make this request of him, but instead he is encouraging him and therefore us to choose and inquire about the reasons God was willing to do this with his son. Why did he fulfill Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim through Daud? And of course, the reasons are many. First of all, there isn't anything that God does alone that he can do with someone. The greatest events in human history are God and someone special, a Moshe, a Noach, an Adam, an Abraham, a Daud, working together. That's what God does. I was just reading today about the 185,000 Assyrians that Yahweh took care of, because the Quran talks about how Allah had thousands upon thousands of angels, rank upon rank, riding on chargers, horses, with their weapons, fighting against 40 overweight merchants and who they killed, and 40 that they took captive. I'm saying, what a pathetic God. Imagine angels so pathetic. There's actually no such thing. It's a Greek word, malach, but so pathetic that it would take 1,000 of them to take on and kill 40 merchants and abduct 40 overweight businessmen. accompanied by 300 Muslims swinging swords at the same time, of course. And I said, let me just give you a little comparison. The Assyrians came into Yisrael and Yehuda a second time. The first time, they ransacked the northern kingdom and hauled 10 of the 12 tribes off to obscurity. And the second time, they started ransacking every community around Jerusalem. And finally, the 185,000 Assyrians settled outside of the walls and gates of Jerusalem. And my buddy, this is why I like the way that God works, Yeshayah. Demeaning Yahshayah by calling him my buddy, I have an affinity for him. I feel very close to him.
It's mutual.
I have tremendous respect for him. And so Yahshayah meets with Hezekiah, who's already done something that really pleased Yahowah. He got rid of all the religious artifacts in Israel, got rid of them all. And then he celebrated what rabbinic Judaism fails to celebrate, Chag Matzah. Pesach is the first day of Chag Matzah. It's not the holiday. It's just the first day of it. Pesach is part of Chag Matzah, not the other way around. And so they celebrated, and they had such a great time, they did it for another week. And everybody was having fun, even with the Assyrians bearing down. There's 185,000 of toughest, best-trained, best-armed military in the world outside of the gates of Jerusalem. And so Yeshayah goes and tells Hezekiah, don't sweat it, man. We got this covered for you. They're not going to fire a single arrow. They'll be gone tomorrow. Not to worry. One malach. That's all it took. One malach in a few minutes. Gone. All of them. We even have historical affirmation. Sennacherib retreats back to Assyria, and he said, I had them like birds in a cage. But it didn't work out so well. He lost his entire army. That's just the difference. But God likes working through people, and so Dode is the person he wanted to fulfill Pesach with. But God and Matzah and Bukurim, even Shabuah. But God doesn't work on the basis of intimidation of obey me. You don't necessarily have to volunteer. He's very persuasive. I can tell you that quite recently, after October 7th, I realized that probably the best antidote Israel had against Islam, which was the cause of what happened on October 7th, it's not Hamas, it's not Hezbollah, it's not Islamic Jihad, it's not Fatah, it's Islam, was Prophet of Doom. And I hadn't rewritten it, hadn't updated it, hadn't done anything for over 20 years. And, oh, God, those were dark days that I was. I wrote that book, Islamic Scriptures, sure. Are hellish. I mean, it's demonic. It's really dark and deadly and bloody and disgusting. And I'm a guy that thrives on evidence and reason, and everything is upside down, and it's inverted. So it's really tough on a guy like me. And so I just knew that was the answer, and yet I didn't. I hadn't been there in 20 years since I wrote it. I didn't know what kind of condition really it was in. You know, you might say, "Oh, how could you not know that?" Well, you know, I'd written 30 books since that book.
Yeah,
that's a lot. You know, and my mind is on what I'm doing now, and so I went to Yah that same day. And said, you know, I'd really like to continue on with coming home. It's an important message, and I really don't want to go back and rewrite Prophet of Doom. And it was just piercing. I have taken care of you. Now, take care of my people. So, God didn't make a demand. I could have said, no, I really don't like that Islamic stuff. I want to stay away from. Plus, the last time I did it, I got 10,000 death threats. That's not a lot of fun either. And no uncertain terms. I've taken care of you. Now take care of my people. He didn't say, I'm not going to continue to take care of you if you don't do this. There's no inference in that at all.
No.
But the inference was, I've done right by you. We've had a great time together. We've accomplished a lot together. And I've prepared you for this moment. Over 22 years, I have prepared you for this moment. You're equipped to do it. You're the only person on the planet equipped to do it, was the inference.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's go do it. That was, will be 5 months ago in a matter of days. And It's been one of the most rewarding experiences of my life.
I'm glad.
Yeah, it's. There are times where it's painful, but the book, Goddamn Religion, is infinitely superior to Prophet of Dumb.
Oh, no doubt, no doubt.
It's far more entertaining, and this time it was written for a single audience,
yeah.
Jews in Israel. Jews, it's written for you. It's my gift, Yahweh's gift. I'm the scribe. And so this is an example. This is what God does. He likes working through people. And sometimes there's not a lot of people willing to work with him. So if you wondered why he stooped to a goy this time, well, first of all, the job didn't require a prophet. There was plenty already conveyed by the prophets. He needed a witness, a troubadour, a herald. A choder, as he would say, wasn't the main branch. Dode's the main branch. Just twig off that branch. That'll do. But no one had listened for a very long time. And if I'm talking to Jews this evening, you've forgotten your God's name. His name is Yahowah.
Yeah.
That name is really important to you. You've forgotten all about the covenant. Five conditions and five benefits. You don't even know what the seven Moed Mikre are. And your celebrations are back-asswards. You treat Passover as if it's anything other than the lamb. You throw what you even call a zeroa, which is a lamb bone, on the plate and fill it with all sorts of rabbinical rituals. One thing you got right, though. On a good Seder, you set a place and pour a glass of wine for Eliyah. Because guess what? He's coming back on Passover, 3 years before the end, 5997, yeah, which happens to be in 2030 on Passover. I'll be joining him there. And so it's good that you've set a table for him. The only thing that's bad is that he's going to speak out against you. He's going to condemn you as Orthodox Jews and rabbis, as he condemned the prophets of Baal.
Yes.
So he is not going to be your friend. So here we are. Why did he work with Dode? Because that's what Dode wanted. My point there was that we don't... Yahweh will not force anyone to do anything, but he's very persuasive. Look at Moshe. Moshe didn't want to go back to Egypt. But Yahweh kept on and said, you know, I think I can make your mouth work. I invented it, after all. And if you're worried that you can't speak enough words, your blabbermouth brother is heading down the path now. He can come along with us. You know, have you figured out who I am in this relationship, Moshe? I just happen to be God. And you know, our people are suffering there. And I volunteered to go with you to liberate them. It's a pretty good deal there, Moshe. I don't know if you think that tending to your sheep here in Arabia is more rewarding or valuable. But that's a pretty good offer I'm making. I'd appreciate it if you'd say yes. He likes working with people. So how did Dode get into this? God didn't even ask him.
No.
Dode volunteered. When you study the Mizmowr in the original Hebrew, and you go back to the way that they have been retained in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and you make a real effort to understand the Hebrew stems, not just the conjugations, the stems and the moods, where you understand that Hebrew has a way to convey volition in first, second, and third person, to convey the will of the speaker, the will of the one being spoken to, the one being spoken about. And when Dode writes of fulfilling his purpose, which was he volunteered to serve as the Pesach Eil, the Passover lamb, and then to do the unbelievably painful part and to carry our guilt with him and to Sheol.
Wow.
He volunteered. And when you read the Mizmowr, you recognize that Dod said, this was my choice. I did it because I wanted to do it. I chose to do it. And then because you can write a phrase both in first and second person volition, he added a second person, and Yahowah, you agreed. This is the way it should be. Now, Dod did it because, well, while he is the most valuable person in human history, the most interesting, the most brilliant, the most beloved by Yahowah, the returning king of eternity, the anointed Messiah, the man that God says, you're the exemplar of the covenant, you are my son, that's a pretty good resume.
I'd say.
Dod realized that in an exceedingly challenging life with lots of responsibility over very, very difficult people, Jews. They're difficult people. And if you don't think that's a fair statement, read the story of the Exodus. Maybe start with the golden calf and end with the waters of Meribah.
Mm.
Or maybe talk about what happened when the quote-unquote spies went into the promised land and what the people did. You're irascible. And Dod was put in charge of these people. It's a tough job. And he did a meltdown at the end. It was too much for him.
Yeah, no shame.
He continued to serve as a great defender of the people, but he made a lot of personal mistakes. And one of his great tragedies in his life was his own family, the pain of his own family, of his daughter being raped, of his youngest son being the rapist, of his second son killing his firstborn son for raping his daughter. That same son leading an insurrection against him, where he was killed, and that tore Dod's heart out.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahowah offered Dod many opportunities to recover, and Dod responded poorly. Dod is so far above my pay grade. I'm humbled just to know him and to be able to talk about him and be able to serve him. And clearly, when it comes to Dod, I'm in servant mode. But nonetheless, Yahowah is very frank about his people. And he told us where Abraham, for example, was a real scallywag. I mean, he pimped out Sarah twice for personal profit. That to me is fighting words. That's a scallywag.
Mm-hmm.
And so Moshe was not. Moshe got it all right. But Dod got a lot of it wrong. And Yahowah goes to great lengths to tell us what he got wrong, because it's important for us to know that the Torah doesn't condemn us for doing something wrong. It makes it possible for us to be perfected.
Right.
When we do things that are wrong, particularly when we come to have the right answers about God and what he's offering and expecting in return, and Dod had those. And so Dod's flaws are important, because if Dod could be so beloved with his flaws, so can we. It makes God approachable. Makes Dod approachable. He's the lovable rogue. And so Dod knew that he had many, many issues in his life and family. And so he knew that if he made this sacrifice over 3 days, he would fundamentally change the world. He would change the lives of his people. He would save them. And in saving them, he's even saving himself.
Sure.
It is the greatest trade-off and calculus that's ever been made. Maximum suffering for two of those 3 days, and an eternity with brothers and sisters who are going to be able to share the inheritance in eternity because we did this for them. Forevermore, I will look at Dod as my savior. I'm here because of what he did. So are all of us.
Mm-hmm.
If he hadn't fulfilled Pesach and Matzah, we have no chance of a relationship with Yahowah or any access to heaven. He did this for us, for himself. This is what he wanted to do. He volunteered. And Yahweh said, you know, you're right. It's the best possible way to fulfill the promise of Pesach, Matzah, and Bakowr leading to Shavuah. Pesach is the door that opens the gateway to life eternal. To Yahweh's home. Or Matzah is the threshold, the welcome mat, where we are cleansed on our way in. And Bakowr are our adoption papers, where we become part of God's family, inherit all that he has to offer. And we receive this inheritance through Dot, because of what he did. We become second and third born sons and daughters on Bakowr. But the way Yahweh works, once we enter eternity, we're all firstborn children. That's what the rabbis have given up. That's what Christians and Muslims have given up. That's what the secular Jews have given up, this great gift on the Son who was given to us. So Dot volunteered, Yahweh accepted, and now they're announcing that the inheritance is from them. It is a nakalah, an inheritance. To a lesser degree, Yahweh was also announcing on Dot's behalf, so that we would understand a prophecy he would make through Zechariah, centuries later. To my view, it is one of the prophecies I can't read to this day, and I have translated it 50 times, commented on it at least that many times, and every time I read it, I break down in tears. I be honest with you, as I'm sharing what our brother, our king, our Messiah, our shepherd, our Savior did for us, I get weepy-eyed. It's tears of joy, but the tears are real. I understand what he did. I appreciate what he did, and I'm so frustrated for him that his people have denied him and themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that these religions have grown up in denying of what he has done. He would make this known through Zechariah centuries later after revealing, I shall cut off the pride of the Philistines, and I will remove his blood out of his mouth and his filthy, idolatrous abominations from between his teeth. God is speaking prophetically of dealing with the wannabe Palestinians in the aftermath of the final Islamic assault on Israel. The enemy with whom Dot was most successful in mitigating, beginning with Goliath, would come inappropriately to camp out near my house, because he who returns, such that no oppressor shall pass through any more. He who returns is the same man who has and will once again camp out near Yahweh's house, Dot. Then this from Zechariah 9 through 12. It's among the most powerful prophetic statements ever revealed. And as a result of the one who is returning, Yahweh encourages Yisrael to exuberantly rejoice, manifest to the greatest extent possible a joyful attitude over the extraordinarily favorable circumstances, singing jubilant songs, daughter of Zion. The President of the United States called himself a Zionist the other day, and I wanted to puke. He has no idea what it means to be a Zionist, nor do even Jews. Zion is a Hebrew word that means signs posted along the way. To be a Zionist, you have to know Yahweh, and you have to know what's on those signs. You don't have to even know where they're posted. They're posted on the ridgeline of Mount Moriah, between Dot's home and Yahweh's home. They speak of the covenant. They speak of the Mikra that lead us there. They speak of Dot. than of Yahowah. Choose to shout for joy, daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Your king. It doesn't say a king. It says your king. Who's the most famous king by a billionfold in Israel?
Definitely Dode.
Actually, you know, there's only two to pick from. Actually, two and a half. Two and a half to pick from. You've got, it starts with Shaul, a people's choice.
Yeah.
He was king over United Israel. He just turned out to be a creep that spoke against the Torah and ended up demon-possessed for it and killed.
Mm-hmm.
And then Solomon after Dode. And he got himself in a pickle by prioritizing way too many pagan women as part of his harem. Mm-hmm. And he lost sight of why he was there. So there's really only one.
Oh, okay.
So it says your king is coming. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to say Dode is returning as king.
Right.
Okay, this is not hard, folks. Your king is coming to you.
Mm-hmm.
This is written by Zechariah. Zechariah prophesied, what, about 600 BCE and thereabouts?
Around there.
550. Malachi was the last. Zechariah was the second to last. Malachi, I think, was 447, to be exactly 1,000 years from the Exodus and 1447. BCE, Zechariah was right before him, so maybe 550 BCE. Dode lived, 1,000 BCE. We're dealing with at least 500 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is 500 years after Dode's life as king of Israel, and it says your king is coming to you. So what do you think he's talking about?
It can
be only one of two events. The fulfillment of Chag Matzah and year 4,000 Yah, and or the fulfillment of Kippurim and Sukkah in year 6,000 Yah. He is right, just, upright, and vindicated. Dode is the ultimate of Sadak. He is correct, righteous, in accord with the standard, innocent, acquitted, just, honest, accurate, and fair. Dode was right about God. And what's more, he provides deliverance and is saved, both straightforward and unpretentious. He provides salvation in a method where he himself is saved. Can only happen in one way, over the course of 3 days. Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim. That's why Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim were the dress rehearsal for what Dode did back with Moshe and the Yatza Exodus.
Mm-hmm.
The children of Yisrael were freed because with Pharaoh having ordered that the firstborn sons of the Hebrews be taken and killed, God felt, you know, I think I've got the perfect response that will get his attention. And so Pharaoh Tutmos, the third's son, was killed that night. It got his attention, and the children of Yisrael were freed. And on Matzah, they left Mitzrayim, leaving religious and political oppression behind. And Bikurim is the celebration of where they cross through the sea and are born as you would be born in a as the womb breaks, the placenta breaks, and you have the gushing forth of water. And
it's
so
a beautiful
this
story.
This is Yahweh's message to us that that Dode's fulfillment of is going to fulfill the promise of Pesach, Matz, and Bikurim as they were lived during the Exodus. In fact, you can go back way beyond the Exodus to Abraham and Yitzhak on Mount Moriah. The dress rehearsal for Pesach, where Yahweh said, I will provide the lamb. Don't harm your son. Your only son. The son whom you love, though its name means beloved. Yahweh is very clear that Dod is his son. And Yahweh says, I'll provide the lamb. It was his son, Dod. And exactly the same place, Moriah, which was the center place of Dod's city of Dod. God told us what he was going to do. It's not hard to put the pieces together and understand that Dod was right and vindicated, and what's more, he provides deliverance and is saved, both in a straightforward and unpretentious manner. His dominion and likeness is from the sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. That would make Dod's kingdom, when he returns, the planet, wouldn't it? But it's just the planet for 1,000 years. After that, it's the universe.
Right.
And while Dod will likely work like Yahweh, Father rubs off on the son, and will have lots of people that he delegates to and works with, the fact of the matter is he gets the responsibility, we get the enjoyment.
Yeah.
Now, since this is addressing the daughters of Zion and Jerusalem and not Gentile nations, your king coming to you excludes the possibility that this is speaking of anyone other than Dod. It is addressing Dod's return to reign over the millennial kingdom, at which time he will inherit the earth from sea to shining sea, beginning to look a lot like the third coming.
Good line.
Staying with Zechariah a moment longer and addressing Dod's second coming and third coming, the prophet said, and for a time I will pour out upon the house of Dod and upon those who dwell in Jerusalem a spirit of compassion and acceptance for those requesting mercy and clemency. And before I read the last of this, I want to have our listeners know that this is speaking of Dod's second and third coming, of him fulfilling the first four Moed Mikre with Yahweh, Pesach, Matzah, Bikurim, and Shavuah, and then returning in the next sentence to fulfill Kippurim and Sukkah. We are fulfilling Teruah as we speak. So he is going to pour out upon the house of Dod. So just in case you were not very smart, and you didn't know that your king was Dod, Yahweh says, I'm going to help you out here. I'll throw you three letters and see if you can figure it out. Actually, in Zechariah, he threw him four letters because Zechariah was one that actually put the Y in, making it Dawid. So I'll pour out on the house of Dod, a family of Dod, and upon those who dwell in Jerusalem, a spirit of compassion and acceptance for those requesting mercy and clemency. We request those things when we celebrate Pesach, Matzah, Bikurim, and Shavuah, which Dod fulfilled in his second coming in year 4000 Yah 33 CE. Then they will be able to look to me, accompanied by the one who they had reviled and pierced. And they will lament over him just like one cries over the most uniquely special child and valued life, anguished and infuriated over him, consistent with the anguish suffered over the firstborn. Maybe the most powerful prophecy ever written. Yahweh says that he is going to return. Yahweh himself. No second coming of Jesus. No return of Muhammad. No Allah. There's no unnamed Messiah here. There's no Hashem. Yahweh. They will be able to look to me accompanied by Esh, Asher, accompanied by the one that they reviled and pierced. And they will lament over him, just like one cries over the uniquely special child and valued life. Anguished over the firstborn. Why that reaction? Because in the 2,000 years since Job did this, his own people have denied him. They actually, 100 years later, foisted Akiba, the father of rabbinic Judaism, foisted a false messiah, Bar Kokhba, which is really where that star came from, son of a star. Denying what Job did, he credited creating rabbinic Judaism a false messiah. And then you had Paul, another Jew, that took every accolade and everything that Dode did, actually said Dode was dead and buried. So all of these promises have to apply to his Iesu Christu.
What a twister.
An imaginary fellow. How do you think Dode would feel? How do you think God feels that we did all of, his son did all of this, and then the people reject him?
Yeah,
that's why
nobody's
going
to settle for that.
Right, that's why we're all crying. The realization of what we did. Finally realizing what he has done. And then look how we treated him for offering us the greatest gift in universal history. Powerful, powerful statement. Speaking of the firstborn. When we read this from the perspective, right perspective, Yahweh's statement should indeed bring tears to eyes. It does me. Rather than recognize the Passover lamb was the Son of God and the Messiah, God's people watched as the Romans tortured him, and then they denied him. Should anyone feel a bit shortchanged at the prospect of Dode inheriting the lands occupied by those estranged from God, and perhaps much more, in fact, certainly much more, I'd like to share what I learned long ago, and that was that owning large estates, luxurious yachts, fast airplanes, isn't nearly as good as being a close friend of someone who does. Dode inherits it. We are his brothers and sisters. That's as good as it could possibly be. We get to enjoy them, but don't have the responsibility of keeping them in running order. We get the enjoyment without the headache. Moreover, the universe is very, very big, so there'll be plenty of room for everybody to play and explore. Moreover, by voluntarily fulfilling Pesach and Matzah leading to Bikurim, Dode earned everything that Yah was offering, including our respect, to begrudge his Bakowr, firstborn, of his inheritance. After all that he endured to make Bikurim, firstborn children, possible, is to be ignorant of his sacrifice. And what did Dode say in the second Mizmowr? I'm giving this all to you. That's the deal here. I've earned it, and I'm giving it to you. That's the questions you should be asking.
Yeah.
That's why he did it, is to give it away. The concept of Dod being God's firstborn son is only presumptuous outside of Chag Matzah, where it is the natural consequence. Dod was the first and only person about whom Yahweh said, "He is my son, I am his father." Adam was the creator's creation. Noah was his maritime mate and thus captain of the ark. Abraham was God's friend. Yishak, based on his name, was a source of enjoyment and laughter, a playmate. Jacob was the father of his people. Moshe was his liberator, the implement and scribe Yahweh used to draw his people out of harm's way and to take them into the promised land. Yosha ben Nun, misnamed Joshua, was his exterminator, preparing the land for his people by ridding it of pests. Shamuel was his most judicial prophet. Dod, however, was all of those things. He was God's beloved son, the man who walked where none dared tread to facilitate our salvation. Guys, if Yahweh offered you the opportunity to fulfill Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim, and you knew what was going to happen, single most torturous death that is possible while being mocked, and the single most hellish endeavor that's ever been endured, fulfilling Matzah by taking our guilt into Sheol, would you do it?
I would want to try, give it my best shot, but I don't know that I have the fortitude Dod has. I mean, I just would doubt myself. Dod's definitely a better man than me.
I might
ideally,
more honest here,
sure,
and tell you that I don't think I would.
That would be tough.
I love you. I love his people. I trust him. That's a real tall order.
And I don't have the assurances Dod had, so I would say no on those grounds alone.
No, that takes a level of courage. That takes a level of character that I'm not even sure Moshe would have volunteered for that.
Yeah, I don't know.
I
would, but I just don't think I could.
I think that being the one person in human history that had the capacity to do that, and the will to do that, is why Dod said, or Yahweh said, that's what I saw in him that no one else saw in him. I think that is what Yahweh saw in him.
Good, yeah.
And fortunately, he doesn't have to see that in anybody else.
Yeah, thank goodness.
Fortunately, our duty is all positive. I've thought about that many times since we figured out that Dod did this. If I realized what was at stake, would I volunteer? And probably not. Probably
I don't
not.
Have the will, that's for sure.
the will to do that thing, I mean, is genuinely extraordinary. And obviously, God's very persuasive. If he needed it to be done, we'd all go along. But we're not going to do what Dod did and say, "I want this to happen."
That's correct.
And we don't have the kind of relationship with Yahweh where Yahweh would say, "You're right, and I want it to happen with you because it's the right thing to do."
I mean, there's not much I wouldn't do for my children, but would I want to? No.
No.
No,
I wouldn't volunteer for that. But yeah, you would. Mama Bear would do most anything for her children. But that's a tall order. That's the worst torture in the history of the universe.
And no one's done it before, so that's really intimidating too.
Yep. And in many ways, we know more about it than Dod did. because we are able to see the whole picture and study the picture, the whole story from beginning to end.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that was an advantage for Dode. The next statement could be in Dode's voice or remain in Yahweh's. If it's in God's, he is continuing to speak. It would suggest that he will work with Dode as he cleans house and removes those infected by the six-pack of human ills prior to his return, religion and politics, militarism and social customs, conspiratorial claims and economic schemes that are based one version or another on the caste system. He may also be saying that he will use many of the Mizmowr and Mashal that Dode has written to shatter the evil nature and mistaken ways of these individuals and institutions. But far more likely, the next statement has returned to Dode's voice, with the prophet conveying that Yahweh has revealed what he's going to do to fulfill and facilitate the previous promise. Either way, it is interesting to see where these things lead. And sometimes the voice is not all, well, the voice is always important, but it to distinguish who's speaking sometimes is not all that necessary. A great example would be today I had the opportunity to read through again and celebrate Debarim 18. It's Moshe's voice about the one who will come after him that will be like him. He's speaking of Dode. And then he goes directly into warning his people about Muhammad and Islam with the false prophet. And it's in Moshe's voice, but it would read no differently if it was in God's. And Dode's Mizmowr were inspired. And therefore, Dode could say it in his voice, or he could say, Yahweh said this. It's the same. So there are certain people, Yahshayah was one of them, where whether it's in the prophet's voice or in God's voice, it's the same voice. You shall break up their evil nature and shatter their mistaken ways with an iron staff and scepter, as if they were a potter's vessel, as a means to contain and control. And then you will shatter and separate them. Prophetically, the beast of Rome was comprised of iron and clay, and thus, with the mention of an iron staff or a scepter, even a molten metal rod or stick, these are such odd things to construct out of lead. We are led to consider Yahweh wielding Dode's legitimacy against the illegitimacy of this beast, especially as Rome has evolved into and become manifest in Roman Catholicism, the European Union, and the United States. That is especially so with the mention of the scepter, something that belongs exclusively to Dode as king of a united Yisrael. What Yahweh will be shattering to facilitate Dode's inheritance will be man's means to mold implements of control, and thus war. He will be liberating his creation from them. Those who have sought to reinforce their positions and who lord over others will discover how fragile they are when compared to the one they have opposed. But of course, more than this, by carrying his people's guilt with him into Sheol and depositing it there, during Matzah, Dode broke his people free, such that we would no longer be bound by our mistakes. That's why Yahweh is so enthralled with Dode, because Yahweh sees Dode as perfect. He sees you and me is perfect. And that is because he and his son, Dode, took all of our guilt and deposited it in Sheol, which is a black hole never to be seen again. So Yahweh looks at us and said, perfect, innocent, look great to me. And that way it's the best of all worlds. He gets to see everything that we do that's worthwhile, that makes a difference to him and his people's lives, without seeing any of the other gunk. It's how we can approach God and not be intimidated, to approach God and not be on guard, to approach God and be completely open.
Mm-hmm.
It's because he loves the things that we are doing together that are good, and he doesn't see any of the stuff that we've ever done that is bad. Best of everything.
Yes.
Absolutely.
We have been warned. Therefore, now, political and religious leaders, military and government officials, choose to be prudent and circumspect, and elect to heed this warning, making the rational decision to defend the land. How many European heads of states? How many Asian heads of state? How many New World heads of state are saying, let's defend the land? Brazil just came out and attacked Israel.
Mm-hmm.
Most of Europe is doing the same. Russia did the same. All the Muslim world.
11 countries since October 7th have cut ties politically.
Yeah. With Israel, not with the perpetrators.
Mm-hmm. Right, with Israel.
With people who are raped and abducted and murdered and burned alive. They've cut ties with them and bonded with the perpetrators who committed those heinous acts.
And Brazil cut ties because their ambassador equated Israel's defending itself to perpetrating the crimes of the Holocaust on Gaza.
Yeah.
On Gaza.
Yeah.
Disgusting.
Oh, yeah.
Parallel.
Yeah, that was the Brazilian head of state, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's stunning how stupid humankind has become. That's why our message isn't designed for progressives. You're not thoughtful enough. You're not reasonable enough to process it. In fact, you're part of the problem, not the solution.
Mm-hmm.
And it isn't for the religious, not Haredim or Orthodox Jews, not for Christians, certainly not for Muslims. We don't want you anywhere near heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Your religion, you can have it. It's all yours.
I like this word. Yes, sir. Choose to accept this correction. Endure conditional punishment. This is an important part of hearing Yahweh's message and onboarding what he's saying to you. It's going to be tough. Onboard it. Accept responsibility. And make a rational decision with that information. It's not complicated, but your ego has to get out of the way.
Yes. He says, my advice to you is that you defend Israel. You know, the last UN vote was only one major nation in the world that voted on behalf of Israel, and that one will stop voting on behalf of Israel very soon.
Hmm.
She's abandoned. Exactly the opposite. Kirk, before we go on, I know that you did some analysis of some key words that I probably skipped right over and forgot to bring to your analysis to the fore. Have some of the words that we have covered so far been part of your analysis, or are they words that we haven't gotten to yet?
No, we got to them, but it was the whole context of it was I, you know, how you've seen thousands of pages that I would translate, and I would also use the letters. So I just stumbled upon these while I was saying that's be a good one to look up. And it was the one that was really most interesting is Jerusalem. So,
yeah.
And I was broken down between Yahweh, the two parts, Yahweh, and Shalem. And as I was doing it, it's been this way for months and months and months now, where it's so much doled in this picture that I can't separate him out of, you know, I didn't see it.
It is just sitting.
No joke. But it's even in the words where I would look at something like a yod or a yod, depending on which one, how you want to pronounce it, and I would think to myself, well, okay, if that breaks down to Yahweh, you know, lifting this up and so forth. And then I would go, well, wait a minute, you know, that's, they're so intertwined now in my thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Dode, it has to be Dode as well. Or I look at it as one helping Dode do this for us, sort of thing. So it's like, so if you break down Yahweh, which is the most interesting word anyway from years ago when we first did it, it's teaching, it's obviously teaching. It's instruction and teaching. It's guidance and direction. That's what Yahweh means, it can never be laws, and it can never be something like the religious people do, because you have free will.
Yeah, because Yahweh is very clear. He says that that his Torah is based upon the verb Yara.
Yes.
So he explains specifically that the actionable root of
mm-hmm.
Torah is not obey. In fact, there's not even a Hebrew word for obey. It's not law. I'm not even sure there is a Hebrew word for law. It is Yara, which is a source from which direction and guidance and teaching, instructions flow. So Torah means source of guidance.
Mm-hmm.
A place to go for teaching. It's such a, I don't know if you could have a better root for Torah than Yara.
No. And if you look at Yahweh just by itself and pictographically, then you've got Yah lifting up, and I'm using it synonymous with Dode as well, because he's leading the pack. He's working with Yah the whole time, it's evident. And Yah lifts up those who shamar his Torah, and that's the carefully, that's not to obey, like all the lexicons will say, and is to carefully consider and closely examine Yahweh's words. What are the promises? What did he say to do if you want to come home? And then the final product at the end of Yahweh is a hey, and pictographically that displays someone who is looking up, standing up, engaged in the walk. Where are they walking? They're walking the path of the Moed Mikra. We're going to Yahweh, or when you're coming home, if you're over here at some point, if most of the people are in Europe, or Jews are now in Yehudim, rather, or and Israel as well, I mean, out of Israel or in the United States or Europe. And they're moving, they should be moving back there, or they at least go to Yahweh through the Moed Mikras and be reconciled. And then if you look at the other word, Shalem, which is interesting, you have a shin and a lamb and a mem. And of course you have, that's the words. In this case, it's more than just the words of Yahweh. It's also the words of the Psalms written by Dode, even though they are inspired, of course. But, I mean, that once again, I just can't look at that anymore with just saying, the words of Yahweh, they have to be the words of Dode or another prophet. And you have a shepherd's staff, is the L, and that's pretty symbolic of our shepherd,
yeah,
our king.
He is our shepherd, yes.
Yeah. And then you have, interesting, you have the mem at the end, which is cleansing water and purifying, symbolic of the Royal Kodesh, is what I would normally say. But then you have two concepts. One of them is that you had mentioned in your, and a little earlier when you were reading it, the concept of the river to the sea, of the land that he will have and control and give to us. But also it's the the cleansing done by what? By Dode when he went through, suffered through Pesach and Matzah and Bakowr, and went to Sheol.
Yeah, the water of Bakowr when they came through the Red Sea lie besides still waters and the 23rd Mizmowr that's all about him serving as a shepherd.
Yes.
That does ties together beautifully, doesn't it?
Yeah, oh yeah, it's all over the place. And so if you want reinforcement, and that's and now, unfortunately, I'm seeing so much of this that, you know, I've been working on the glossary, and I just finished all the verbs. And I was moving on to the nouns once I put some grammar in there. But now I almost feel like I need to go back and put all the pictographs in there as well so you can see the whole picture. I have to live this year. To finish this off, or I'm going to go crazy. And, you know, but I'm going to have some
Hebrew is one of those few languages where the graphic depiction of the letters as they were originally formed tell a story.
So every
word can be analyzed this way with the letters that that form the words, and their legacy is still with us. I mean, they are in fact defined this way. You know, Beth is a great example. Beth means home in Hebrew. It was drawn in the letter Beth was drawn in the form of a home.
Mm-hmm.
So Ain means I in Hebrew. Even to this day, it was drawn in the form of an I. Yod in Hebrew is the letter vocalized now as Yod was originally vocalized as Yad, and Yad means hand, and it was drawn in the form of a hand.
Yeah,
it's really not all that difficult to see the legacy of the original pictographs that conveyed the meaning of these words, and you know, that is the alphabet that the Torah would have been originally written in.
Oh yeah, and then Yosha, we found out, you know, with that lead thing discovered, he kind of sealed the, you know, he just sealed the point. I mean, there it is. That's, he buried it. There it is. You know, pictograph. So, game over. Anyway,
yes.
It's just anyway.
Yeah, it's a beautiful language. It's a beautiful message. And it's just something that written so casually by God. You know, therefore now, political and religious leaders, military and government officials, choose to be prudent and circumspect, which is hard to do if you're a progressive, and elect to pay attention to this warning, making a rational decision to defend the land. And of course, they're all opposed to it.
Yeah.
All of them. You know, ultimately, during the last days, it's going to boil down to one man's stance on Israel. Every political and religious leader, each military and government official who isn't circumspect in this regard, who isn't choosing to wisely support Yahweh's people, his place, are going to be destroyed. One's patriotism and faith will not matter, and it will likely be counterproductive. Where we stand on Israel is what counts. It's why we do this program. It is why we've written the 30 books of Yada Yah. It's why we're rewriting Prophet of Doom as goddamn religion. It's all done for a love of God's people, for Yisrael, and to defend them against a world that is falling apart and turning against them. So while that conclusion is valid, let's never lose sight of the fact that this contains a referendum on Dode, the beloved son, and his prophetic insights regarding what father and son will achieve together. And it is that very point that Yahweh is reinforcing now at the conclusion of the second Mizmowr. It's hard to believe that we were actually talking about the second Mizmowr as we went into Zechariah. It might have seemed like a lifetime ago, but here is Mizmowr 2, verse 11.
Okay.
With reverence and respect, work with and serve alongside Yahweh, and rejoice to the point of quivering. That's pretty good advice. With reverence and respect, work with and serve alongside Yahweh, and rejoice to the point of quivering.
Stand it off, y'all.
Yeah, no one in all of human history did this better than Dode. His passion to serve was only exceeded by his intellect. As a result, he is our point of contact with God. He opened the door and set out the welcome mat so that we could come home. And considering the cost and his relationship with God, denying any of it is going to do nothing but engender wrath. And that is as it should be. Father and Son work together so that we might live. To have made this sacrifice only to have it discredited by the religious is unconscionable. Mm-hmm. It's a crime against the people to whom it was offered. And no one has done more to hide and negate what Dode did to provide life than rabbis. As you consider Dode's next pronouncement, now take note that he used bar instead of ben for son. Very unusual. To show just how uncommon this is, bar only appears four times, while ben is used 5,000 in the Torah and prophets. The reasons are twofold. First, what follows is unlike anything we have seen in the Torah and prophets. This next refrain speaks of our perceptions of Dode and of the consequence of disrespecting him, which is a life and death decision. We are being told that our fate is subject to where we stand with the Messiah and Son of God, which is as it should be. This is because he is our Savior. He's the one that endured Pesach and Matzah leading to Bikurim, fulfilled through Shavuah. His sacrifice is the source of eternal life, leading to the perfection of our soul and subsequent adoption into the covenant family. Second, in recognizing how unique this statement is regarding the interrelationship between Dode and salvation, it calls for the kind of elucidation a special word like bar provides. More than a Ben's son, the Messiah is bar. He's the radiant and favorite son, the brilliant and purifying heir. Dode is Bashar, the chosen one, therefore Yah's bar favorite son. Dode is intellectually brilliant, as we have learned, but he is also returning as bar, as brilliant as the sun. Most importantly, by serving to fulfill the mikre, Dode bar purifies the souls of the covenant's children. Further, as Yahweh's Bakowr, firstborn, he is the bar, heir, with the ultimate inheritance. In addition to sun, in bar, we find the illuminating and enlightening child with an inheritance who chose to provide moral cleansing and intellectual understanding. It's quite a word. The bar is selected and dispatched to conceive supernatural children who are radiant, fostering favoritism among those choosing to participate in this special relationship as sons and heirs. The bar contributes to the conception of the descendants who are bright and pure, akin to cleansed and purified grain, symbolic of saved souls, thereby paving the way to an inheritance, to enlightenment, and to comprehension. The bar is a son and a whole lot more. Reach out and touch. Contacting as a sign of affection, demonstrating your mutual adoration for the relationship with the radiant and favorite son, the brilliant and purifying heir, Bar, the illuminating and enlightening child with an inheritance who chose to provide moral cleansing and intellectual understanding. Lest he becomes indignant and displeased, and you perish in this way. Indeed, his righteous indignation can be kindled for a few and for very little, comparably. Joyful with me and blessed by me, Asheri, are all who put their trust in him. Dode is no longer being subtle. It's long past time to be subtle. I don't think he was all that subtle in the 22nd Mizmowr, and yet it took me 20 years to figure it out. Oh, duh, it's written in first person because he's talking about himself.
Yeah.
It wasn't until retranslating all of the Mizmowr and working in the moods, these volitional moods, first, second, and third person, that it finally said, oh, my God, he's volunteering to be the Passover lamb. And Yahweh's agreeing. And so I guess he was just too subtle for us. But not here.
No.
Yahweh's basically saying, listen,
right,
you've irritated him for the past 2,000 years, rabbis. You've denounced him. You've denied him. You've denied yourself. You've denied your people. You've replaced him with a warlord. You've plastered over him with your religion. You've deprived your people of life. Denied them of the great sacrifice Dode has made. God's saying, you know, maybe you've over-irritated him. And since he's your savior,
you're in trouble.
Kicking at him, spitting at him, is a really bad idea. Pretending that you have a Star of David is insulting. Pretending that there's a Messiah coming and you don't know who it is humiliating. Pretending that there's no salvation in Judaism when he saved the children of the covenant. Asinine. So God's just not being subtle here. He's saying, you know, one of the perks that comes with having done this is if Dode doesn't like you, you don't benefit. And Dode's not going to like you if you've denied his people of what he has done. Now, of course, the positive side is, why would you want to deny your Savior? Why would you want to deny your King? Why would you want to deny someone that's offering you the inheritance of the universe? Why would you want to deny someone that's saying, I'm going to give you a gift that gives you eternal life, that perfects you, that causes you to be adopted into God's family, to be enriched and to be empowered and to be enlightened and to be emancipated? That is the gift I'm giving you. Why would you want to upset that person? No, you're a real jerk. I don't want those gifts. How dare you offer those gifts to me? And what Dode is basically saying, if you're going to be that big an idiot, I don't want any part of you. It's just like I said, I don't want religious people in eternity with us. So mess it up. So God's saying, you know, he walked the walk.
Yeah.
One of the perks is if he doesn't like you, then it's just over for you because there's no other means of salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Almost infers, too, that if he really likes you, that he has some advantages because of what he did. I know I have naysayers on this, and I could be wrong, but the Torah and prophets seem to indicate that I'm right on this. It's just intuition on my part, and it dawned on me very, very powerfully the moment that I first realized that Dode volunteered to do this, is that he loved Absalom.
Yeah.
And
I get that.
Absalom did something horrible, but so did Dode from time to time. And yet Dode loved Absalom. And if I'm Dode, I'm going to Yahweh and said, okay, realistically, I need this. You need this. but you really do need this. You need me to do this, Yahowah. I'm the only guy that can do this. I'm prepared to do it. You've enabled me to do it. I volunteered to do it. You really need me to do it. I want something in return. And that is, I want this for my son. I want to overlook everything that he has done. I want to be able to take his guilt with me and deposit it there too. I don't know. Maybe I'm pushing it, and it's just I'm looking for motivation because of what Dod volunteered to do, and
right.
I mean, to know him and his passion for certain things. I can see him saying, I want to get my own family straightened out too. That we're doing this, yeah, for your family. And I know that your family and my family are the same family, but I really do want to benefit my family too. It just seems so very dote. And it seems so very Yahowah to say, yeah, of course. You know, benefiting from all of the things that Dod did, he's now perfect again. So anyway, that's what I think. So I think I think Dod has authority. That's what this says, by the way, that Dod has very unique mm-hmm. authority in this regard. If mm-hmm. he doesn't like you because of what you've done, that it's over for you. And if he likes you because you followed his advice and with respect, you've chosen to work with Yahowah, that's going to endear him because you've chosen to be his troubadour and announcing what he has done for his people so that more people benefit from his sacrifice. That's going to endear you to him. And those who he loves, has the authority to say, yeah, that's part of my family. That's
I think it makes sense.
Yeah. So anyway, that's my thoughts on it, and this is one of the I think what we're talking about in terms of Dod volunteering to fulfill Pesach, Matzah, and Bakowr, what it means, how he did it, why he did it, what it how we capitalize upon it, what it means right now for Yisrael, how Dod is also the one that is going to fulfill Yom Kippurim, anointing the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant, as is required to reconcile the relationship. Dod is our king. He is our brother. He is our savior. He is our shepherd. He is the firstborn son of God and the Messiah. Coming to recognize that he is all of those things, and no one else is all of those things, is, I think, the single greatest discovery of the past 2,000 years.
Yeah.
And it's one of the gifts that Yahowah has enabled us to share. It's not our gift to give, but it is our gift to share.
Yeah. Both
and
right.
Yes, and I am thankful for Yahowah for enabling us to be part of this message to Troubadour and Herald.
Yes, sir.
The work that he and his son did together. Well, good night, Yisrael. Good night, all. We speak to Yehudim, but we're happy to have Goyim, like ourselves, join in Yahweh's family. We're calling you home to Yahweh, to get to know him by name, by reputation, as a father, to understand what he's asking for us, from us, to be part of his covenant family, what he is providing in return, and how our willingness to reply favorably to his seven Moed Mikre enable us to capitalize on this marvelous gift, and how Dod plays such a magnificent role in all of it. So thank you to listening to the second Mizmowr. We'll return to you this time next week as we near this year's celebration of Pesach, Matzah, and Bakowr, as the moon's light renews and becomes full within this month. May Yahweh bless. Good night.
Good night, y'all.
Night,
Kirk.